And let's welcome the players onto court. From Scotland, the number one seed, Kirsty Gilmour. And her opponent from Denmark, Anna Tia Madsen.
There she is then, Kirsty Gilmour from Scotland, the top seed, fans' favourite here. Can she go further than last year when she lost in the semi-finals? She was runner-up in 2013 as well, so she would be delighted to go one step further and get the win here. It would mean so much to her. She's on course to be Britain's representative in the women's singles at the Rio Olympics. Everyone wants that home title here at the Scottish Open. She's the second highest European in the rankings behind Carolina Marin. And she's the Scottish number one and the British number one as well. 22-year-old Kirsty Gilmour, world ranked 20th. It's been as high as 16th in the world in September of last year. She's born in Bells Hill and now resides still in Glasgow. She made her international debut in 2009. Silver at the Commonwealth Games 2014 at this very venue. Happy hunting ground for her. There's her road to the semi-final, yet to concede a game. Julie McPherson, first round fairly comfortably, then Rode from Denmark, and then Mine, the Japanese player, in the quarterfinals. That was how she got there. Very strong play from Kirsty Gilmour. There's just confirmation of her age, her ranking, fact that she's just six ranking spots away from her career high. She's in great physical form. You can tell that she's shunned none of the work physically. She looks muscled and lean. She's had three wins this year, played 15 tournaments, Swedish Masters, Prague Open and the Dutch Open were the tournaments that she's won. Came runners-up at the Belgian International as well, semi-final at the Bitburger Open recently, quarterfinals of the US Open. So a really good, solid year from Kirsty Gilmour. Turning our attention to Anna Thea Madsen. She resides in Svinninge in Denmark. She's 21 years old, just a year junior to Kirsty. There's her road to the final. Again, she yet to concede a game as well. So in that regard, both players relatively fresh. Beat Petra Nedelcheva in the opening round. The eighth seed ousted. That was a good win for her, especially not to concede a game as well. And Davish Eichbergen in the quarterfinals. Good win there as well for Thea Madsen. So both players in rich vein of form coming into this semi-final. Her best memory, she quotes, as being the 2014 European Championships when she won the silver medal in the women's singles there. She's played 10 tournaments this year. Not a great year for her. A couple of semi-finals in Poland and the Finnish Open. A couple of quarterfinals, Swedish Masters and Dutch International. That's about it, really. A couple of round of 16 appearances. There's a coach, Danish man.
And on my right, Kirsty Gilmour, Scotland.
He's the umpire, João Fragoso of Portugal. And the service line judge is Alan Antoine.
Level play.
Gilmour to get us underway.
One love. Service over. One all.
In by a country mile, Gail, by badminton standards, that one.
Yes, yes, definitely nerves. And also,
two,
the court
one.
Is different. Every court's different. And when you come on to a semi-final, sometimes those first few points you use to judge what's happening, how you're feeling, how the shuttle is floating.
Service over.
All these little things that just you need to know to help your confidence. So for Kirsty there, there was a leave that she wasn't sure where the drift was going, which way, there was a side drift, a length across the court drift. These are all, you're just trying to suss everything out at these early stages.
3, 2.
Brilliant tight net shot from Madsen there. They've met, this is their third meeting, and they are level in their head-to-head appearances, one all. In October, Kirsty won in the Bitburger Open just last month in straight games, 21-8, 21-19. But it was the Irish Open 2 years ago that Madsen won
in three
close games. So the same coach stayed on court, coach of Hans Christian Vitingus. I was just about to say, the precision of Madsen, quite something, right?
No, just floated out. Absolutely spot on by the Lions judges. They do a fantastic job here in Badminton. Absolutely fantastic. I wouldn't like to do what they do.
It's a thankless task.
It is a thankless task, and they've been absolutely excellent this tournament. So I just thought I'd give them a big shout out.
Yeah, no benefit of Hawkeye Challenge electronic review. That's tough, isn't it?
It is, and from a player point of view, you want to see the shuttle out, or you want to see the shuttle in. So you are biased. You have this unconditional bias towards that shuttle, whereas you've got to trust these line judges. They're sat there, they're concentrating. I don't like seeing players
berating them.
Exactly.
It's not fair, is it? For me, it's a thing of beauty. The end range control of these singles players is just, just jaw-dropping.
Fine.
And what's lovely to see with Kirsty, and I've said this a few times since the Commonwealth Games, is I like the way she's taken on women's singles and put her power into it. She's very athletic, and she's not one of these, ladies singles who are just, all about delicate finesse shots. She is asserting herself straight away. And she dives around this court. She's got real physicality about her. And that's what I love to see.
Yeah, I said a few minutes ago, she certainly hasn't shunned the work. You can see by her muscle definition, she's strong. She's been in the gym. She's done those hard yards.
And I think that will be the difference between these two players over the course of the match. The physicality of Gilmour compared to Madsen. There's a presence about her as well. Whereas Madsen just doesn't quite have that.
Yeah, she's diminutive in stature, relatively, in comparison.
7-0.
Still nothing between them, though, on the scoreboard. Parity.
Eight, seven.
Well, Madsen's using a lot of disguise on her shots at the moment. I think this may be one of her tactics. If she can't physically outrun Gilmour, maybe she's got to use that extra disguise on her shots.
So quick to close the net there. Testament to the fitness. Explosive first step.
Well, Kirsty Gilmour's been playing, she used to play a lot of ladies' doubles as well with Imogen Bankia. And that has developed her game as well, that movement from the back of the court to the front, being more decisive and aggressive at the front of the court has really, really helped her singles.
Over. Over.
Yeah, we haven't spoken about the pressure of expectation.
Your
home tournament desperately wants the title. That's a tough dynamic mentally, that one, isn't it, for this young player?
It is, and she's dealt with pressure a lot over the last few years. And for someone so young to have that put on her shoulders, it's a tough task for her. And, you know, ever since Glasgow got the Commonwealth Games, she was primed to be the star of Badminton Scotland. And she responded in amazingly well. And she did great because she got that silver medal. A real, real massive boost for her confidence to be a badminton player. And that's her coach, Chris Brule. He's formerly of the Netherlands. He used to be a singles player himself, and then he turned his hand to mixed doubles. So she was working with Yvette Yinlo, a Chinese coach, who's now moved away for family reasons. So Chris has stepped in. So I'm not sure how long they've been working together.
They were together at the World Champs.
Were they? Yeah, oh, that's good to know. It's good to know that Chris, I know he was brought in before the Commonwealth Games. So it's good that he's been there around for her. Because there is, as a player, you need that consistency with a coach as well, who knows you and knows how you work.
11-9, play. Service over. 10-11. Service over. 12-10. Service over. 11-12.
Brilliance from Madsen there, who just had Gilmour at full stretch. What a point.
That was an incredible cross-court backhand net shot. The skill to do that. It means coming in early with your racket and just using your... It's such light touch with your fingers as well, just to turn that racket and just cross it over. And you keep that shuttle so close to the net. It crosses the net very, very close to the tram lines, and just at the last minute dips. Very, very good skill. And
looks like Kirsty's sort of winded herself on landing there. That was a full-on goalkeeping dive in attempt to turn that point around.
This is a girl I've seen bandaged up from her dives, not from any injury.
13,
it's bandaged
11.
Up from her dives. So it's been skin burns from her sliding across the court.
She's going to need all that physicality now, you'd imagine.
Oh.
Madsen, exquisite.
She's gliding across the court, which
14-11.
Very, very impressive to see. And
ghostly speed as
yeah,
well.
Yeah, it's very
quite
ghostly.
Eerie, isn't it?
It is. She doesn't make a sound.
15-11.
I can imagine that's very off-putting. If you're playing someone like that, who, you know, we've mentioned before, she's very, very slight in stature, and yet she's not making a noise, and she's got this incredible touch around the net.
She's stealthy and very, very dangerous, the red-shirted Dane.
11.
And more importantly, there's a real hush around the Emirates Arena here in Glasgow as she has a five-point lead. And that's what they think of that smash.
Yeah, that's much better from Kirsty Gilmour. A lot of her smashes have been to the racket or too far into Madsen's body. And this time she made sure she was aiming closer to the tram lines. Much better from Gilmour.
Service over.
It's like Anna-Teja Madsen really is in the zone right now. She's seeing the shuttle like the size of a football.
Yeah.
17-12.
From a spectator point of view or a playing point of view, I'd really want Kirsty to step up the pace a little bit more. This is playing into Madsen's comfort zone. This is very, she's not having to move too quick. She's not stretched too far. Kirsty's just got to push it up a gear. She was listening to me.
Yeah, I think so, yes. Well done.
Service over.
That was much better. 13, she was pushing 17. And probing Madsen into the backhand rear corner. That sets up that short lift that she can attack.
Wait.
It's a hard, grueling physical semi-final, this one. Madsen again continues
over
with the precision hits.
18-13.
Yeah, but it was slow from Gilmour to react to that smash. It's not something that Gilmour's not, couldn't not get that. It's something she is quite capable. It's just moving, she's got to get her feet moving quicker.
Better.
Service over. 14-18.
So still concerning times then for Kirsty Gilmour, who's very much up against it by this Danish onslaught. So are we going to see order restored here? Top seed really up against it. She was trailing 18-13, reduced it back now. Outrageously good. So Anna-Teja Madsen, she doesn't have the
19,
power to overwhelm
16.
You that much, but it's kind of death by a thousand cuts, isn't it? She's coming at you with just so much all the time. Level of fitness is supreme.
Oh, these two girls are incredibly fit athletes. For me, that was a disappointing rally because Kirsty had opportunities to increase the pace and she didn't, and allowed Madsen to stay in that rally.
collective sigh around point, the 16. Emirates Arena as Anatea Madsen has 4 game points. Produced some of the best badminton you'd imagine. I didn't expect this.
No, I didn't either. But this is sport. This is sport. This is what happens.
And you've got to deal with these sort of emergencies, haven't you?
Exactly. And whether it's Kirsty's just needs a bit more time to find her feet, or maybe she can still win this. She's not down and out of this first set yet. I've seen Kirsty come back from a 20. Lot lower than... I think she came back from 2012 down at one in the Commonwealth Games to get into the final. So this is a girl who never, ever gives up. It's just whether she can just produce the right shots at the right time.
Game.
Well, the answer to that is no at the moment. 21-17 for Anatea Madsen. The lesser-ranked player is ahead by a
first game
after just
by
16
Madsen,
minutes.
21-17.
Yeah, I think the crowd are not not too happy that their Kirsty Gilmour has lost that first game. But you know, you mentioned expectation before. Whether that is playing a part. Kirsty's on posters here. She's been in all the national press. She's a Commonwealth silver medalist. There is a lot of pressure on her to go and win this title. I think even in the programme notes that there's not been a Scottish winner, a ladies singles winner since 2009. So, you know, it's already out there. And this bit of all this information will be in her head. There is no doubt about it. And it's very easy for other people to say, well, just ignore that. Ignore the expectation. Ignore the pressure. Ignore the crowd sighing when you hit that in the net. But you do. You're human at the end of the day. And you'll hear things. And things will affect you. So for her now, I just want her to play her game. I don't like seeing her not play as Kirsty Gilmour can play.
I mean, obviously, she's looking to give Scotland more success, what with both Blair and Banquier sort of win over the last couple of years in doubles, mixed doubles. But is she being allowed to play, though? Is that the issue? Because Tia Madsen is just really raising the bar, isn't she? I mean,
maybe.
It looks a very strong performance from her.
Yeah, it's a great performance from Madsen. And I'm not taking anything away from her, but Gilmour's been in many situations like this before. She's young in age, but she's experienced with badminton. So for me, I'm a little bit disappointed she can't assert her authority on this match
level.
Already.
Play.
So training a game then, Kirsty Gilmour, top seed. Start of the second game.
Service over. One love. Service over. 1-0. 1. Service over. 2-1.
Again, it's getting used to the different side. Those first early exchanges are very important, just judging the drift. Spot on from the line.
3-1.
Madsen just bringing her racket across the shuttle too much.
Good leave, very drift aware. That one slides over the back
4-1.
Well, different complexion on this game already, Gail.
Yeah, and you'll see that Gilmour's using the forehand high serve a lot more on this side, but she will change her backhand for a short serve. More control.
Anatea Madsen is evidently struggling with the drift from this end.
Maybe there's a side drift as well. Mm. We have seen it hanging in the air, just drifting from left to right.
Service over. 2-5. Service over. Six, two.
Complete contrast to the opening game then, Anatea Madsen.
Seven,
all at sea
two.
In this second game since changing ends.
What's really frustrating for Madsen is that we're guessing there's a drift from left to right, and yet she's still hitting it that way. If I was her, I'd be hitting it the other side.
Quick nod of acknowledgement then, in some having received some words of advice from a coach.
Yeah, you are allowed to coach in badminton. You're allowed to
Eight,
give coaching.
Two. Play. Out. Service over.
Crowd still rather
Three,
subdued, Gail.
Eight.
Yeah, it's again putting that pressure on Kirsty. We want to see the Kirsty Gilmour style of badminton. That's what we know and love, and we want to see her aggressive. We want to see those, those
Four,
jump smashes, the
eight.
Dives across the court. This is not the game. She's playing against someone who's very delicate, who glides, hasn't got that power game, and always taking that power game away from Kirsty. So
service over.
The crowd can't get into it as much as they'd like.
Yeah, the jump smash, normally a big feature of her game.
Massive.
9-4.
That's what we like to see in badminton. We like to see that athleticism, but this is not the game for that.
And again, not reading the drift from left to right. You're right, just unusually tactically unaware.
It is frustrating as a player when you're playing in a hall where there is such a drift. But, come on, that was really out. You've got to aim those. You've got to adjust your style and where you're positioning.
11-4, interval.
For it.
So that serve landed in. And there's a 7-point deficit in the favour of the top seed now. 11-4, she leads. At the mid-game interval, and there's been a complete change around in momentum here.
I'm trying to lip read. Lip read is not my speciality, but Chris Brawl, I think he would be just trying to encourage Kirsty just to keep going. She's got that momentum with her now. Manson's making the unforced errors.
20 seconds.
I would seconds. Like Kirsty to step up a gear when she can, and it's just that experience that she's got now. So when she sees those moments, she's got to take them, and that would just make Madsen start thinking more, start thinking, oh, can I really do it?
11,
start questioning in herself.
Play. Service over.
I'm fascinated with Tia Madsen just missing on the right of the court, almost like she's trying to get to the backhand of Gilmour, just that little bit more, perhaps.
Of course, that would be, if that's her tactic, but
Six,
to miss
11.
By such a margin is not good enough. And all we have to do is just pretend the tram lines are a foot further across. That's all you have to do, but like I say, it's easier to say than do it.
Good court
over.
Awareness from Kirsty Gilmour there.
12-6.
Electing to leave that one.
Out. Service over. 7-12. Service over.
With someone like Madsen, who's got a natural 13, reverse 7. Slice to her racket as well, she's got to, if this is something that she continuously does in these big arenas, she's got to look at her racket, how she hits that shuttle, because when she's playing straight, it's fine. When she's beneath the net, it's fine. It's
13.
When she's up above and an overhead shot, it's a natural wrist action to go that way. And yeah, this is, it'd be concerning.
Almost.
It was full. 9-13.
Great idea from Gilmour here, just to shove the racket up. And sadly, it was not quite the right angle in response, but good play from Thea Madsen.
Over.
That's what they came to see.
Fourteen-9.
Yeah, that's great power.
I love the way she followed the shuttle with her body weight as well afterwards.
Yep.
Oh. Service over.
Just out.
10-14.
So, Thea Madsen, who was 11-4 down in this game, has really done well to claw that deficit back. Stands just 4 points shy now. Getting frustrated now, Anna.
15-10.
Yeah, as soon as she prepared for that shot, you could see her wrist was just, her racket preparation was too open. You knew that was going to go out. Well, Madsen's continuously to put, well, she's using that backhand corner for Gilmour. And Kirsty at the moment is using it to her advantage. She got round the head. Perfect slice smash down the line.
So she's at the better end, right, Kirsty Gilmour now?
Yes.
Because the drift, so to speak, 10. Metaphorically, is on her face, if you like. So she can stand, presumably, a little closer to the net. Almost anticipating drop shots and things, is that
yeah,
the idea?
That's it. And it just, you know, you can see how your opponent's struggling with that side. It makes a massive confidence boost as well.
Oh! A roar of delight from Kirsty Gilmour, top seed. Just 4 points away, 3 points away from levelling up here at a game all.
18-10.
Roar of the beast awoken.
Rally from Gilmour. This is what she's about. She covered every 19, single centimetre of that court. She was spot on. Great disguise here. But for me, that was absolutely fantastic. Absolute top, world-class shot. She held that shuttle and just at the last minute flicked it over Madsen's head.
Lady luck on her side as well. 10 game points for a game all.
20 game points. 10. Service over.
What I like, though, is that Kirsty Gilmour looks far more expressive now. 11, the game is starting, 20. The handcuffs are off, and the performance is really starting to show and ignite. Still 9 game points.
Game.
A late call, but it was indeed out, so she steadies the ship. Wins the game 21-11, and after just over half an hour, we're on level terms. And this match, like so many so
second
far today, will be decided
by
a third and
11.
Deciding game.
One game all.
Giving the fans plenty to cheer about now then. Kirsty Gilmour, top seed. 2 minute turnaround of the game. The court will be swept. Get any beads of sweat off the court. There's just confirmation in the scoreline.
Yeah, I think it's quite frustrating this game because I don't want to take anything away from Madsen. I think she's been absolutely perfect in her tactics to slow Gilmour down and just bring a sense of skill and deception into the match rather than all-out power and speed, which would be feeding into the hands of Gilmour. But for me, you know, it's frustrating to see Gilmour accept Madsen's style of play and accept that she tried to match her in that first set. So if Gilmour can really come out guns blazing in this third, really go, right, bring it on. If you're going to slow it down, try your best to, because I'm going to be so quick. That's what I want to see. And the crowd, they can't get into this match at the moment, even though Kirsty won that second set pretty convincingly. There's nothing they can really grasp and feel with it. So I really want Kirsty to just get out there, so the crowd get involved and just lift this place. It's a little bit flat at the moment. Madsen, who knows? If she can still keep Gilmour slow, she's got a chance of winning this and creating an upset.
Final game. Level play.
Brilliant. At the very top half of the draw, and Gilmour is
one
the
love
solitary remaining seed. I can confirm the opponent that she'll be facing in the final, if she does win this, would be Lena Kirschfeldt of Denmark, the fourth seed, who had a win over Beatrice Corrales, the second seed. Good win for her there.
Service over.
It's so interesting, isn't it, the athlete's perception. I mean, Anatea Madsen might be really just enjoying that end. And in her mind, it's about bigging that up, isn't it? And just trying to take all the positive she can, bolster herself.
Lovely change of pace.
Over.
I'm not sure if she really meant that shot, but it doesn't matter. Coming in, she just did enough. She was really reaching around the head and she put that reverse slice on and managed to get enough angle down. Madsen just couldn't quite reach that.
Two, one, play.
The crowd really are buoying her efforts now, getting behind her and seeing some
three,
of
the
athletic badminton that they've been familiar with over the years.
Yeah, much better from Gilmour.
Three in a row for Kirsty Gilmour.
4-1.
Familiar failings for Madsen.
5,
spilling out
one.
Wide of the right of the court again.
Service over. 2, 5. Service over.
Well, the smallest of margins can have the greatest
six,
of consequences.
Two.
Gilmour with a 4-point lead here, 6-2 in the decider.
Service over.
It's only just out the back.
Three.
The right shot.
Six.
Deep into Madsen's forehand, rear corner. Getting that height as well, but just too much power.
Four, six.
Okay, girls, there is a drift from left to right.
Yeah.
No, not that way.
No,
it doesn't drift
exactly.
That way.
It's interesting, though, isn't
five,
it? The power
six.
Of calm as a commentator compared to when you're in the heat of a battle as an
exactly.
athlete down there. It's, you know, it's, your head's like a washing machine, isn't it? Brilliant close and dispatch that goes with it.
7-5.
Quick to pounce. Deceptive
service
brilliance
over.
From Anatea Madsen, showing us her
six,
large array
seven.
Of skills around the net there.
Kirsty Gilmour went for a very, very high clear, so it gives Madsen time to put that skill and deception on her shots. I'm convinced
service
by that
over.
Tactic because you're giving Madsen time to produce that slice and,
eight,
and just
six.
Trying to wrong foot Gilmour. So for me, I personally would rather her do flat clears, push Madsen's into the corners where she's struggling because she's not as athletic and she hasn't got that time to put that deception onto her shots.
You're absolutely right. She seems to be taking her time away more now, doesn't she?
Yeah.
Her smiling as well.
9-6.
Delighting the crowd with that.
It can also be very frustrating when you're playing against someone who's a very different style of play to you. It's not always as enjoyable because you've got to play outside your comfort zone and you're not quite sure
service
what to
over.
Expect.
7,
a great
9.
Great cross-court smash. Very hard to do, hit that power from the back of the court from someone who's very slight as well. Great technique to be able to do that.
Yeah, no oncoming power from the shuttle.
8-9.
Got to be careful here, Gilmour, to stay in the ascendancy. Now Natea with the momentum now. 2 points in a row for her.
Service over. 10-8. Service over. 9-10. Service over. 11-9.
Well, Gilmour goes into the mid-game interval 2 points ahead, and she'll have to dig deep and rekindle those memories of their last win a month ago in the Bitburger Open, where she won 21-8, 21-19, and hopefully that'll put seeds of doubt in the mind of Anatea Madsen, who's really contested this match very, very well.
She has, and she Well, at one stage we were thinking there may be a big upset, and the Danish girl was going to upset the Scottish crowd here. But credit to Gilmour, she's hung in there. She's not playing. This is not her best badminton, but you know, sometimes it's not about that.
Seconds.
It's just producing what you need to do to get to the next round, and she's just about managing to do that. Madsen's making a few more errors, whether that's Kirsty's pressure or Madsen's own pressure on herself, thinking, ah, I could be beating Kirsty Gilmour and be in the final. So I think this is going to be a battle of wills, and if Madsen can stop hitting it into the tram lines this side, if she can stop those errors, then it might be a close affair in this third set.
Gilmour in her favoured end, you feel. She's been much more effective.
Thank you.
Facing the camera from the far end, if you will. Here she is with a two-point lead as we resume in the deciding game.
11-9.
Vying for the final.
Express enough how great a smash that is.
12-9.
She really gets up for this, but it's that power and that trajectory that she gets. That it's absolutely awesome. When you're on your own in singles, you've got to cover every single angle, but to get that steepness is very, very, very good.
On the rampage now, Kirsty Gilmour, top seed, looking very, very expressive.
And this was using the drift again. She took the pace off. She hit. She didn't do much slice on it, so she just used the power of the drift so it would stop right in front of Madsen.
Service over.
Good play from Madsen, just bursting the bubble of momentum that Gilmour just built. So effective with that short game, isn't she?
She is. I think Kirsty needs a range of knee pads and elbow pads. A bit like volleyball.
She could endorse them.
Yeah, she could. Or just wrap cotton wool
13.
Around her.
Yeah, she's a tough cookie.
Wait.
Brilliant from Madsen, and again Gilmour flailing, diving to the floor in desperation.
Yeah, Madsen broke a string on this shot, a cross-court drive. She put all of her body weight into that shot. She didn't hit it cleanly. She caught the top of the racket, hence why the string broke, out of the sweet spot. And if Kirsty got that back, Kirsty would have probably ended up winning that shot. Very, very hard to win a rally when you've got a broken string.
11, 13, play.
Brilliant from Kirsty Gilmour. There's a physicality that the crowd have fallen in love with. And a wry smile from Anatea Madsen back to her coach.
14-11.
She knows that the task is just really tough.
And also she hit that shot with the drift again. Mm.
And again. It's funny, isn't it, Gail? The patterns of play that you live and die
15,
by, it's tough to suddenly
11.
Change it, I would imagine. That seems to be the situation out there. I'm sure her coach has made her aware of it by now.
Exactly. Okay. So in her head, she's thinking, don't hit straight because you're going to hit it in the channel. So let's hit cross. But with that, she just forgot about the power as well. So, lots of things to think about.
Played Kirsty Gilmour, who extends her lead. 5 points.
16-11.
For me, it's the physicality. When you look at the body language, she's much more expressive. She's into this. Thea Madsen, in contrast, is just that little bit smaller and stiller. A And again, she's just, you can see her berating herself, Anna-Thea Madsen there. Why am I hitting it still from left to right?
11.
It's funny, isn't it? What do you think if you don't think pink elephants are pink elephants? She's almost like, stop doing it, but she can't.
Exactly.
Some of her tight net shots are exquisite, there's no doubt about
18,
it.
18-11.
Madsen, again, familiar failings, just shuttle spilling from left to right, and it's been her downfall today, to the delight of Gilmour, I'm sure. Good smash. Now, is this too much deficit to claw back for the red-shirted Dane? She's shown a lot of character in this match,
18.
You have to agree.
She has, but I think now with the way Kirsty's playing and the mistakes that Madsen's making over and over again, it'd be very, very, it'd be hard to see her coming back from this. Oh, no.
Another.
Service over.
You could count those on three
19,
hands if you had them.
Yeah, I think so. And the worrying thing is we can see it straight away. As soon as she hits that, we can tell that it is going to go out.
So after 48 minutes then, Kirsty Gilmour
match point,
has
12.
8 match points.
Yeah. Service over.
A bit too greedy with the finish, wanted to finish in 13, a flurry there, 20. Did Gilmour. Still has room to maneuver here.
Play.
Absolutely delighted with that. A terrific turnaround on a very tough afternoon for Kirsty Gilmour. Top seed safely through. She's all smiles. 49 minutes it took her against a very tricky opponent. 20th ranked player in the world through to her second final
Match
showing here
Kirsty
as
Gilmour,
she did in 2013.
17, 21. 21, 11, 21, 13.
Big hug from the coach. She's delighted. Anna-Thea Madsen was always going to be a very tough opponent. 53rd ranked in the world. She's been as high herself as 35th. But today, it's all Kirsty Gilmour, who extends her head-to-head lead over this player. 2-1 now. She's delighted. Just peruse the stats quickly. There we are, Gilmour with the most consecutive points. She put several runs of points together and in the end, well, won far more points overall than Madsen, who just couldn't get to grips with the drift from left to right. So shortly we'll be hearing from our winner. Gail's ready to talk to her now.
Kirsty, congratulations through to the final. When that final smash went in and on that floor, you looked very relieved.
Yeah, I mean, she was just on form today. She had her running shoes on, just things I expected not to come back did. So she made it very difficult. I think you could probably see both of us were a bit edgy today. There wasn't many, like, really, there was a lot of tough rallies, but they were all very kind of tense. So hoping to have a bit more like peace on court tomorrow, but I'm really glad to get through that one.
From up where we were sitting, it looked like she was trying to slow you down. Did that feel like that on court?
A little bit, yeah, but we're both quite nippy, we're both quite jumpy, you know. So I thought it was just a battle of wills, who could, you know, be more accurate and that kind of just more safe, but with good shot quality. I think that was the real battle there.
There's always a lot of pressure on you now. You are everywhere you see your name, your face, the papers. Do you feel that pressure here at the Scottish Open?
A little bit, but it's kind of nice pressure. You know, it puts me in the best position possible and it gives me the most support possible because everyone just means so well. So I really appreciate everyone that comes up to talk to me and things. Sometimes it's not quite at the right moments, but I appreciate all the support, every clap, every shout. I hear them all, so I really appreciate it.
Well, I think the crowd will be firing for you tomorrow. Congratulations, Kirsty, into the final tomorrow. Well done.
Thank you very much.